What's up, guys? It's me again, Chemical Engineering Guy. I'm going to guide you to this tutorial about how to treat or how to account for reactions in mass balance, or how to do mass balance with reactive systems. So we just saw the break. You already know how to do a mass balance in 1 unit, in 2 units, and also in multi-units. Also with recycle and bypass. If you don't know how to do it, or you think you need to review that, I do recommend it, because if you don't get this, you will not get the next section. Now, this was with no reaction, okay? We had a reaction. But now we want to actually do mass balance with reactions. And this is way much like interesting. I love it. But first, we're going to cover some theory, so let's hit it. Reaction basics kinetics, it's more or less, you don't need to know that much, but just have an idea. Stoichiometry is the most important part. You do need to know it, because stoichiometry is the relationship between this stuff here. You have 2 and you have 3. When you have 1 of B, you produce 3 of C. It's your relationship between stuff, the matter, atoms, molecules. So it's very important to know it, guys. So please make sure you know it. And finally, as I told you before, it's way interesting, because before we had only inlet, outlet from the mass balance equation. We always like cross this because we had no reaction, no production and not consumption, but this time we cannot cross it. What we are going to cross, it's actually the accumulation, because we are in steady state. So we are going to finish with this equation. Just to let you know an example, a 1 reactor, let's say we feed A and we produce B and C. Nothing is accumulating inside. All the things that go through A convert to B and C, and B and C are going out. Good. Now, I told you something about the stoichiometry, which is here. Stoichiometry coefficient, it's easy. Coefficient ratio, that's easy. Balancing equation, it's super basic. I think you know it. Hopefully you do know how to balance an equation. These two guys, limiting reactant and excess reactant, are kind of tricky, but it's okay. Percent of conversion, it's very important, especially for reactor and reactor engineering. And this is like the super golden rule, the extent of reaction epsilon. Good. Let's continue with coefficient. A coefficient, or stoichiometry coefficient, is nothing more than a number which is applied to a mole or molecule in a chemical reaction equation. So we got this equation, which essentially says propane and oxygen will turn or react to carbon dioxide and to water. These numbers here, 5, 3, 4, are stoichiometric coefficients. Actually, you have one here, but it's not shown. So you wanted to know the coefficient, you know it's 1, I told you before. It's, you know that, it's 5, it's 3, and no, this one is 4. Never mind, it's 4. So just take in mind that the stoichiometric coefficients are always in front or before the molecule in the equation, which is already balanced, guys. Please make sure it's balanced. Now, the ratio is another thing. It's a relationship between 2 species. It may be a product and a product, it may be a product and a reactant, and it may be also a reactant and a reactant. Actually, everything with everything. You can relate these two, or you could relate these two, or you could relate this, and this, etc. So, I bring you an exercise here. Relate, please, ratio AB, A to C, B to A, and this one is kind of tricky. So, I'll give you some seconds, so you pause the video, try to do it, and we continue. So, let's continue. Now, We've seen, this must be 5 to 1, or 5 mol of B per each mol of A. Now we have this, this is 1 per 5 again, or which is 0.20 mol of A per mol of B. You can continue and continue and continue, and this one is what I wanted to show you, ratio of C with C. It's obviously 1 to 1 because it's the same substance. Now, let's balance an equation. From the mass principle, we already saw it, it's all matter will not destroy itself or will not create in the universe. So, we cannot create it, not destroy it, just transform it. The same applies for atoms and moles. So, let's do the next thing. Example of propane, this equation, let's balance it. I do recommend this, especially for combustion. You're going to see combustion reactions at the ending of this chapter. Actually, it's shown mass balance in combustion. So I recommend you to at least get used to this. So let's balance it. First, balance carbon, which is the most important part of the equation. So we have three carbons here. We would like to have three carbons here. What do? Simply multiply by three. Ignore oxygen, ignore hydrogen at this moment. Now, we want to balance H. H is easy because you will not move any carbon while balancing. So if we have 8 here, I would like to have 8 here. So it's 2 times 4, you will have 8. 8 hydrogens to the right, 8 hydrogens to the left. 3 carbons to the left, 3 carbons to the right. Also ignore oxygen. And finally, which is the important step, balance the oxygen. So we have, count all the hydrogens, all the oxygens in the right is 3 times 2 is 6, plus 4 times 1 is 4. We need 6 oxygen. But we do have oxygen as a molecule, not as a single atom. So just divide 10 by 2, and you should get the answer, which is 5. And we got our final equation, which is one molecule of propane will react with 5 molecules of oxygen gas and will give you 3 moles of carbon dioxide and 4 moles of water. I bring you more exercises, overviews, how to do balance equations. If you want to do it, please just stop it, read it, see it, and continue. So this is the time to stop it. I'm going to give you some seconds. And let's continue. The stoichiometry balance, I give you some practice problems, please just balance them. As you can see, it's not balanced. You only know water, CO2 are being produced, but you have no idea of the coefficients, so please balance them. Now let's go to something more, a little bit interesting. It's limiting reactant, which, for example, if we got this equation, A plus B will react to C. We need 1 mole of A and 1 mole of B to react. If A is a little bit less than 1 mole, we won't be able to achieve 1 mole of C. Why? B will not react completely also. So let's say we have 0.5 mole of A and 1 mole of B. And how much are we going to create? So it's so easy, because if you, for example, let's say you need one bread, let's say 2 breads plus 1 cheese plus 1 piece of, lettuce. You need at least 2 breads and at least 1 piece of cheese and at least 1 piece of lettuce to do a sandwich. But what happens when you only have half? You wanted to do a lot. Let's say you wanted to do 2 sandwiches, but you only have 1 cheese and you only have 1 lettuce. Well, you will be able only to do 2 sandwiches, because even though you have bread for 2 sandwiches, you only have cheese and lettuce for 1 sandwich. So we are going to be able only to do 1. These are limiting our sandwich production. and this guy, it's overfit or in excess. So, as I said before, A is limiting reactant because it's lower. B will, of course, be left out. So we will have probably, if we wanted to do the sandwiches here, we will have two breads as left out or leftover. And we will not be able to react all C. We'll have two leftover there. So hopefully you get the idea. If not, go review your chemistry class because that's typical chemistry course. Now, B, I told you before, is in excess. You have leftover. You are able to react more B, but not A, because you don't have A. So this is what happened. What will happen if you have multiple, like B, F, and H? One important thing is to know there's only one limiting reactant, and there will be three excess reactants, because by definition, excess reactant is something that is left after the reaction. So this, let's say it's 0.1 mole, you have 1 mole, you have 2 mole, and 2 mole. You will not be able to react to the completion of these guys. These will disappear, of course, and will turn to C, but these guys, you will have leftovers. So I brought you some exercise, just watch them, click them, pause, I will give you some seconds, and then we continue. Good, hopefully you understand it. We're going to the next exercise, which is a limiting reactant, how to get a limiting reactant. Hopefully you know it, because it's very important, we're going to see it a lot. Give you some seconds to pause the video and do the exercise. Good. Now let's continue. Stoichiometry. We're going to talk about conversion. We have the same reaction, A plus 2B, reacts to create C. But what happens, and this is very typical, even though you have a lot, like the perfect stoichiometric relationship, you will not achieve 100% conversion, which means you will not react all the reactants. So we are going to measure this by percent of conversion, which is a very easy concept. It's the amount of reactant A versus the feed of A. I have the equation here. It's how much do you feed and how much do you have at the outlet between how much do you feed. This will give you a value between 0 and 1. Why? Because of course the outlet can never be more than the inlet. So hopefully you get that idea. If not, please go check again with your chemistry classes. And I bring you an example. 100 mol, 50-50, and they produce P, which is 40, 10, and 40, A, B, C respectively. So I wanted to check the conversion of A. I want to know, well, I actually know the feed, which is 50, it's here, minus the outlet, which is 40, didn't react, which is here. We divide in the feed, so it's 50 minus 40 divided by 50. You will get 20 fraction or 20% reacted from A. So please make sure we didn't actually need B, C, or P, so you don't need to balance the equation or the system to calculate the conversion in this case. Now, this is a very important theory that we're going to see, the extent of reaction. It will help us to do the mass balance. Let's continue. We have now this equation. Imagine you have this, A plus B will give you 2C. This applies always, independently of what type of reaction. And I means any species, is the actual amount of moles of the species I. It could be water, it could be A, it could be B, carbon dioxide, I don't know. Now, when I say NiO, this is actually to denote initial. So if before it was moles of a species I, now is initial moles of a species I, which we already fed. Good. And epsilon is the extent of reaction. What is that? It's the amount of reaction that already reacts. And we will have this guy here, it depends if it's reactant or product, but it's mainly the coefficient of the species. So if we wanted to check two Now, if you wanted to check C, it's plus 2 because it's a product. You're producing 2 moles. If we wanted to check A, it will be minus 1, and B will be minus 1. Depends if you're a reactant or a product. Now, guys, at any moment, we can have this equation. Please prove it. I am sure it is true. If not, read the book, because it's so easy to understand that the things you feed here plus the coefficient you're producing, or if you're reacting, you're consuming, it must be multiplied by the extent of reaction. And normally we're going to use it backwards. We're going to look for the extent of reaction. We just look for it. Something like that. You will read this as actual moles of E, or species E, is equal to moles of fed of I plus or minus, depending, the coefficient of I, or species I, in the reaction times the extent of reaction. It's hard to get, so I do recommend to go to examples. And this is the first example. They show you this, and you have the initial feed here. So they tell you apply this rule, please. So let's do it. From the given data, we know initial is 100, 300 of B, 0 of C, and 1 of inert. E means inert. Inert means doesn't react. And let's check the coefficients. It's minus 1 because it's reactant, minus 3 because it's reactant, and C will be plus 2. So we just go to this equation and substitute values. This is the 100 we saw here, and minus 1 will be here, the V1 of A, it's 1, negative. Do the same with B. It's, this guy is 300, we have it here, and minus 3 because it's here, times epsilon. Okay, good. Finally C, we have no C, so it's 0, and we do have plus 2 times epsilon, so we have it here, and inert, by definition, it's only this, because epsilon will never talk about the inerts. So good, we add all this stuff up, we have total moles of the initial conversion, minus, you need to add this will be our extent. Now they show you this equation, and they tell you that it's equimolar feed, and that the initial feed of A is 100. So therefore, the initial feed of B, it's 102. They ask you to find the limiting reactant, the excess, if there is, how much is left, if there is excess, and what will happen if the conversion of A is only 50%. So good, let's go for the limiting reactant, easy. From this equation, we're going to substitute the data. So I have this special rule. It doesn't have to be this way, but I like it because when you don't want to think that much, you just want to do numbers, you just do this. Let's find epsilon for each. So we have this from A, we just substituted data, and this from B. You bring this, you know, this number, you know it, and this is okay. And you do know this is also 100. So what will happen if you equalize this to 0? I mean, what happens when you reacted all actual moles? You will prove that epsilon in this one is 100 and not 50, and this one is 100. So one trick I use is always this rule here, the smallest epsilon when you equalize the formula to 0 is the one that will limit you. So this time this is the limiting, and this is the excess guy. So A is limiting and B is the excess. Now they ask me how much is left. It's easy, we know only that the here this extent of reaction is simply calculate epsilon, you calculate 50. So let's say the actual moles, or the moles at the end, or at the ending, will be the initial moles, which is 100, because it's equimolar, and the epsilon, which we already calculated, is 50. So it's obvious you will be having 50 mol of B left to react. Now the excess, if any, I showed you before, is 50, and well, we already know this. This was what we calculated before. The excess is simply inlet minus outlet divided in the outlet. So 100 is what we fed of B. 50 is what actually reacted, so it's left 50. This is tricky. 100 minus 50 will give you 50, and 50. So you will calculate 1, which is 100 excess. Normally, when you say 2 times, you're talking about 100 extra. Now, finally, for this example, what will happen if you have this? You will react less. I did a table. Initial, you have the same conditions because it's the same process, but reaction will be different because now you're going to react only 50, not 100. So we have minus 50, therefore we have minus 25, and therefore we produce the same. This is a stoichiometric relationship. So we just add this up. This is plus 50, plus 75, and plus 50. That will happen. So guys, hopefully you understand this. I'm going a little bit fast because this is about chemistry, not that much about mass balance. So if you are getting problems, please check your books of chemistry, reread, do examples, please, because we are going to use this a lot in the mass balance. Actually, we're going to apply this to the first mass balance. We have this reaction, 1 mole of A, 1 mole of B, 3 half moles of C will give you 1 mole of D, 3 mole of E. There's 100 mole of it, so that's cool. Let's do it. Actually, what you're going to know, this is air. Only C is air. Here is air. Anyways, let's continue. We have the diagram, and because this is air, we actually know that 21% of this is oxygen, and 79% of this is nitrogen. So change all air composition to oxygen. So it is easier. You need to multiply this 78 with this for oxygen and this for nitrogen. You get 0.10, 0.12, you already had it, but this is new and this is new. Good. Now, we're going to choose a basis. I recommend you to choose 100 so you can get all the percentage very nice here. Now, we need all the stoichiometric values of the equation. We need to balance it. I think it's balanced. So let's get 1, 1, 3 half. Because these guys are reactants, we're going to put them as negatives. It's 1 I told you here, the 1 I told you here, and 3 halves I told you here. Now 1 and 3. 1 positive and 3 positive. Nitrogen doesn't intervene in the reaction, so it's only 0. Now we're going to substitute in the generic equation, which is this one. You already know. We saw it in exercise 1 and 2, so just put the values here. Remember everything. Actually, have the same look, all the initial moles and all the extent of reaction. Only nitrogen has no, because it's only inert. And finally, you got this, which is the total mole. And just substitute initial moles, because you know initial moles, then all this data, you know it. No initial. We're going to calculate the limiting reactant with the rule I told you. So check this. And what happened when you put zeros in here? You will get epsilon in A is 10, so this will give you 10, this will give you 12, and this will give you something like 10.66. So if you compare, epsilon A is the least or the smallest, so this is the minimum. So A is limiting. Good. Now, calculate the percentage of excess of the other two reactants. So this is easy. Now we can react until 10. We just substitute data in the equations, and you will get that 2 moles are left of B and 1 mole of O2. Excess, just inlet minus outlet, give it 20%. And inlet minus outlet gives you 6%. Good. Now, conversion is 30%. What will happen? Just check the extent of your reaction. If 100% is 10, 30% should be something like 3, but it actually is true. So we're going to substitute in all the epsilons. So you get these 3, 3, you don't need this, you have this and this. We're going to get 7, 9, 62, 3, and 9. Oh, also this one, sorry. This is the final composition for this example. So, I'm sorry I did it so fast and didn't explain that much, but this is only mass. This is only chemistry, stoichiometry. It is not mass balance. I just want you to understand that you gotta be good at this because we're going to use it a lot. So, the next chapter, next topic we're going to take up, care about is chemical equilibrium, how to account mass balance with that. So, make sure you get this because probably we're going to use it later. So, in general, I hope you're getting the idea of what we are going to do with the mass balance in the reactions. So, see you in the next video and take care, guys. What's up, guys? It's me, Chemical Engineering Guy. So if you like the video, why not push the like button? It really helps me to know if you're liking the videos or if I should be changing something or I should be adding something, taking out content, whatever. Also, sharing is caring. So if you got any kind of friends, teachers, colleagues, or whatever kind of person that might be interested in this type of content, why not share it? Sharing helps our community to grow faster in members and in content. If you want to keep track of my activity, videos, uploads, experiments, playlists, whatever content I'm getting on YouTube, be sure to click the subscribe button. Subscribing to the channel is totally free, guys. My dream is to create an online academy of chemical engineering, where everyone can access it in the world. Imagine a place in which the student, the teacher, and the engineer get the best of each other. Thank you, guys, for the support and the love.